Joining us for the first time now, the team from Magdala has put this together to be able to prepare all of us to live a very deep, profound, transforming Easter as we take these steps in the pilgrimage one by one, day by day through Lent, as we walk through the Holy Land inspired by Abraham, our father in faith. So if you see behind me, you see that there's a river. In fact, we're standing right on top of the main spring of the River Dan. And so what I wanted to do as we talk about this in just a second is to give you three things as we begin our walk through this wonderful place. I'm going to give you a little bit of the liturgical, like how we are situated liturgically. geographically and then historically. And so first of all, liturgically, we've got water here. Most of you watching this have actually not really been focusing on water, but you've been focusing on the ashes that have been put on your forehead or on top of your head during this Lent. And so we have these two images of ash or earth and water. And it's interesting because when you receive the ashes on your forehead or on your head, there's a lot of different things the priest can say, but usually it's from dust you came, into dust you will go. It's an invitation to remember that we are earth, that we need the grace of God, you know? And then if you look at this water, the symbolism of water is so clearly one of grace. It's clearly one of new life. And what's neat about this river right here, Dan, is it's coming up from the earth right beneath our feet right now. And this river, actually, is one of the tributaries that's coming down from Mount Hermon, and we'll see that in some future days during our pilgrimage. But it comes down and it joins other tributaries to make the great River Jordan. And Jordan is, of course, the place where Jesus himself was baptized. It is the place on this pilgrimage where we will also renew our baptismal promises as a sign of renewing our faith. And so what a perfect place to begin our pilgrimage, in this source of grace, in this source of new life, as we have the ashes over us, as we're, you know, going along this river, along this pathway through Lent, to make our way to the new life that Easter gives us. So that's our liturgical context. So let's talk a little bit then about the geographical context. For those of you who have been pilgrims to the Holy Land, I don't know how many have had the grace to come up here in the north to Dan. But I want to tell you a little bit about where it is. You go up further towards Syria, which is northeast. And you've got the Golan Heights here, Lebanon up here. It's a beautiful crescent of mountains. In fact, the highest mountain in this area, Mount Hermon, like I said, is just right over in this area on your, you know, original map. And so Dan is right up here at the top. In fact, if you look this way, and we'll head that way in just a moment, and you keep going, you'll actually end up in Lebanon, crossing the mountains. And so this is where we are. And then, thirdly, I wanted to give you a very brief historic context, because we'll be talking about this in a couple of other places that we'll visit here. So like I said, this is called Tel Dan, T-E-L Dan. Tel is a word that you may have heard before in cities like Tel Aviv. And so I wanted to tell you, Tel is a term that's used in archaeology. And it's a hill, but it's not a natural hill. It's actually something that archaeologists can look at and say, that's a man-made hill. In fact, if you dig into a tell, you will find different layers, different strata of civilizations going back thousands, hundreds and thousands of years. And that's actually what this is right here. It's a tell. And so underneath this, we're going to find history that goes all the way back to Abraham. We're talking about a history which is 4,000 years old. In fact, it even goes further back. They found historical writings, and they found remains of even the Egyptians who made reference to this area of the Holy Land, of Dan. They've also have, you know, the Canaanites were the ones that were here when Abraham came through. Even before that, they found remains from the beginning of civilization, the first men who walked the earth around this area. So this is our historic context. It's extremely rich. But again, let's remember the title of our pilgrimage. Pilgrimage in Faith, Inspired by Abraham. So what we're going to do now is make our way toward one of the gates of the ancient Canaanite city of Dan, which was actually a different name. I'll explain that more when we get there. And we're going to see a beautiful gate, Abraham's gate, that he saw with his own eyes 4,000 years ago. And let's go for the pathway. Welcome to Abraham's Gate. This is the most ancient part of the city of Dan. In fact, it used to be called the city of Laish, and that was in the time of the Canaanites. So let's go back in time. Remember, I said that we would be here 4,000 years ago. And so this is a gate from the Canaanite city of Laish that's dated, the archaeologist who uncovered it, at about 18th century BC. Who lived at that time? Abraham himself. So why do they call this Abraham's Gate? It's not just because when you look at it, it's extremely ancient, and it is a gate from the time when he lived, but it actually has to do with his life. Abraham, of course, our father in faith, came over with many of his family members. One of the members of his family that came over was Lot, and he was a nephew of Abraham. If you remember, they came into the Promised Land, and Lot chose to take a certain area close to the Jordan, and Abraham decided to go to a different part of the country where he could also be with his flocks and his family. So what happened is some kings came into where Lot was living, and if you remember the story, he was down toward the south in Sodom and Gomorrah. Well, before it was destroyed with brimstone and fire, there were these kings that were warring and came and took Lot and many others hostage. They took them and they took them away. And they were making their way from the south up here to the northeast and into the area that we now know as Syria. Abraham found out about it, and he said, I've got to go rescue my family member. So he made his way up here and came to the city where the kings were and where Lot was being held. And so the only place he could have come in, this patriarch of ours, this father of our faith, who came with about 400 of his own servants to fight this battle, and he actually defeated all four of the kings, was right through that door and into this ancient Canaanite city. That's remarkable. These stones witnessed him, his life, his love for his family members. Witness this great man of faith who left his home in Mesopotamia and Ur of the Chaldees to come where our Lord wanted to show him. He left everything and trusted completely in God. This is what's remarkable about this gate. Just as an archaeological note, the man who discovered this, it was back in the 70s, and then they started excavating it further. When he discovered that this archway was intact, and there was a tunnel through it, they actually put some earth in it to make sure now that it's uncovered that it wouldn't collapse. It is actually one of the most ancient arches that is still standing in the world. So you're looking at one of the oldest standing archways in the entire world. So this is absolutely remarkable. And so this is why it's called the Abraham Gate. Made it here to the uppermost part of Tel Dan. That means it's the highest level of the ancient city. And so you see behind me all of these stones that look like a building. What we're actually in front of is the temple complex, which is fascinating. We'll go in just a second. But I wanted to show you this picture that they put up here. And it speaks about, well, obviously in the picture you can see a sacrifice of a calf or a bull. And you can see the people worshiping, you can see the priest making the sacrifice. And then there's a quote here from 1 Kings, and it talks about Jeroboam. So Jeroboam was actually the king of the northern tribes. That would be Israel. Remember, under David, which was about 1000 BC, Judah and Israel were all together in one nation. And then his son Solomon took over after him. And Solomon was a wise man. It was the gift he asked for from God. But he had hundreds of wives. And many of his wives were foreign wives. And so they didn't know Yahweh. They actually worshipped other gods. And Solomon allowed them to build high places. In fact, officially, this is a high place. This is a place where sacrifice was offered on a very high hill. And that offended God. Because Solomon knew from his father David and from his own faith that there was only one God, and that was Yahweh. So what happens is God tells Solomon, you know, your kingdom will be divided up. In honor of your father David, it won't happen in your lifetime, but afterwards it will. So Jeroboam comes into the picture because as a steward of Solomon, not even his son, but as his steward, he breaks off with the majority of the tribes of Israel, meaning the northern part, the northern kingdom, have this as one of the sanctuaries where they offer sacrifice to a Yahwehist. In other words, it's not a place of sacrifice to an unknown foreign god, but it's the God of the Jewish people. So this is who Jeroboam is. Now let's go inside. As we walk through the gates of these ruins, you can see that there's different kinds of stones around us. What you can notice from where we're standing is this is a courtyard. There's a lot of courtyards when you go into a place of worship, a cult place, as they call this. So this is probably where the people could come in. And if you look a little bit higher, you'll notice there's another opening, and this is where the priests would go. Because if you see behind me, there's this metal structure. And what they've done, the archaeologists, is they put that metal structure with four horns, in other words, four corners on that structure, to remind us that that was probably the large altar, the size of the altar, where they would bring the sacrifices here in the northern kingdom. And so it's quite large. And here to my right, you can also see this interesting round structure. And for those of you that like archaeology, you can look inside and you'll see some plaster right in there. And so if you ever see something like that in a round structure, it means that it's waterproofed. So this is a place where you can come and be purified and wash away also the blood from sacrifices, because you can imagine what a bloody business it must have been. So this is definitely a temple area, northern part that Jeroboam set up here. We'll see Bethel, I think, tomorrow or later on in the pilgrimage, where he also set up another place where people could worship. So let's go into the priestly section. And you can see up close, especially now that I'm in the scene, how large this altar may have been. And here to my right, I'm actually going to do something with you as a pilgrim. We're going to walk up these ancient steps that would have kept going, where we can offer the sacrifice. Now, as we do this, I want to come up to the other part of this area in just a second. But as we do this, think, okay, these people were offering sacrifices to God. They believed in him. They loved him. They knew it was important to make him the center of their lives. As we begin this Lent today, it's very common for all of us to think, what is my Lenten sacrifice? Look at this altar. What will I offer? Let's think about that as we make. To make our way up even further, even higher to this high place. We can even look down onto the altar. And so you can see there's a dais up here, like a platform, and you can see the beautifully worked stones and everything. But what I wanted to just mention, being up this high, is that even before Jeroboam, which again is about 940, 1,000 years before Christ, this place was actually a place where the Canaanites also worshipped. It was very common in ancient civilizations to take the highest point, to go up into the mountain to encounter the divine and to put themselves at the disposition of the divine. And we'll talk about that a little bit more when we go down into the city. But also, if you look out here, you'll see in the distance Lebanon. And then to our right, we're looking into the foothills of Mount Hermon. And so this is how far north we are in the Holy Land right now on our pilgrimage. And certainly during Lent, we want to go up into the high places, to the mountain, to be able to encounter God, who's also looking for us. Let's continue our walk down into the ancient city of Lent. So as I lay our staff aside on this first day of our pilgrimage, I'm laying it right down on the seat of authority, actually. As I explained, and the sun has come out, we circled back and came here to the city. This is the place where the king or the head of the city would come. There's different places where the elders can sit, and in the entrance gates of a city, of an ancient city, is where you would have negotiations, you would have judgments, you would have discussions, and that's why you needed the king with his elders to be able to come up with a decision. So that's why we're here with our staff of authority, and we're going to talk a little bit about why we came to Dan on this first day of our pilgrimage. Pilgrimage in faith, inspired by Abraham. Well, that's the main reason. Dan being that ancient city, and as we saw over by the gate of Abraham, it's a place that we know he saw. Our father in faith 4,000 years ago was here. I mean, we could have tried to go to Hebron, where he first came into the land of Canaan, it says in the Bible, and try to find an oak tree that would be 4,000 years old. We don't know if an oak tree can last that long, but what we do know is that these rocks, these stones, this place is still here. They have been witnesses to faith. They have been witnesses to Abraham, our father in faith. And so, as I had mentioned in the introductory talks, to our pilgrimage, which you can see those online if you haven't had a chance to watch those, it's important for us to remember what faith is. You know, we said that faith is entering into a relationship. And this is the main way that Abraham becomes an example for us. There's a relationship that he begins to have with God, his God, because he is attentive to revelation. He's able to hear him and he responds. And we'll see in just a second that he responds in a radical way. So radical that it actually talks about his trust. So we have to keep that in mind first and foremost when we talk about Abraham and when we find ourselves in a place like this, in the city, like a city of Dan. So as you also noticed in our, as I also explained in our introductory talks, we have a lamp that's with us all the time of our pilgrimage, the lamp of faith. And when we listen to what God says, and just like Abraham, he took a small light, but inside his heart, and made an interior pilgrimage. Remember, not just an external one. We're doing both during this time of Lent. We're making an external journey. I'm walking around for you in the Holy Land, but it's also this invitation to take this internal journey. And so that's what he did. But in a sense, he rose and he left his land in response to an invitation. But he's actually demonstrating something that comes from humanity in general. When we were up at the high place here in ancient Dan, we could see the large altar. We could see the altar at the entrance of the city gate.
You can find altars like that throughout the Holy Land and throughout civilizations in the world. We'll be able, God willing, to even see the place where the altar was that Elijah built to prove that God is the one God. And so it just speaks to something that is part of the human condition. We are religious by nature. Mankind will always seek for the absolute. That's why an author that I really love, she's the founder of something called the Madonna House, and her name is Catherine Dougherty. And she wrote a book about pilgrimage. We'll be making reference to it throughout these next weeks. But she speaks about all of us being pilgrims of the absolute. In other words, we're seeking. We're always seeking God. We're seeking the divine. And that's what we can see in places like this. And that's what Abraham had in his heart. He was a seeker of something greater. And I remember when I first went back to the United States and had some time with my family after being out of the country for 12 years, you know, as a consecrated woman, we're assigned in different places. And so I was out of my own country for a while. And in the meantime, when I was away, there was just this digital boom. And so in different family conversations, you know, questions would come up, hey, what's that flower? Or do you know what that is? Or what's the name of that peak over there? And the immediate response of my family was, well, let's Google it. And so immediately there was a search and there was a search. Oh, it's this, that, or the other. And like I said, it's like the human heart is the search engine. We're always looking for what is this? What is this place? Why is it like this is the next question. What did the people do? How did they live? But then that always brings us in our human nature to say, what's the reason? What's the ultimate meaning of all of this? In fact, especially during this past year with so many difficulties we have faced at a world, you know, worldwide, many people have stopped and said, what is the ultimate meaning of life? A lot of the distractions have fallen away. A lot of the pleasures have fallen away. Many people have lost jobs, their honor, their respect. There's a lot of evil that we've been confronting. You know, why on earth are there viruses? Why are we confronting the horrible reality of death and sickness? All of these things can actually take away from our search for God, or we can actually stop and just say, well, I'm indifferent, or I'm just irritated. Or we can think about some of the difficulties that we faced over this past decade in particular, with bad examples, you know, scandals in the church, scandals among people that we think should be God-seeking, God-fearing people. And many times that just makes this pilgrimage, this internal pilgrimage, or even the question of the ultimate meaning of life seem meaningless. But just like in one of Matt Maher's songs, he says, you know, those questions that we raise, those thoughts that we think, they have meaning. I'm alive and I'm breathing, and that means I'm constantly searching. It means I constantly should have my ear open to the revelation of God. And so what I wanted to do is just read in Genesis. It's the very beginning of Genesis, after Noah and Noah's descendants, of which Abraham is one of his great-great-great-great-grandsons. What happened when he first listened to God? And you can find it in Genesis chapter 12, starting with the very first verse, and it says this. Now the Lord said to Abraham, Abram, go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you. And I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great, so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and him who curses you I will curse, and by you all the families of the earth shall bless themselves. And then it continues. There he built an altar to the Lord, and called on the name of the Lord. And Abram journeyed on. This is why he's our example. Go. He hears that invitation from the Lord. Leave everything, your country, your kindred, everything. Go where I will show you. It's interesting, Abram at this point, he models for us the fact that we constantly need to search. We are constant listeners. We're listeners to him. We have to listen. Go, leave, I will show you. And it's beautiful because God, in this revelation or this call, as man searches, always brings us to a place of blessing, just like what we read. I will bless you. I will bless the people who bless you. I will bless your descendants. But then he goes to the point where we ourselves are living out what God said to Abram right here. By you, all the families of the earth shall be blessed. We are blessed. We have been given the faith that he himself acted out. And he continued to listen. He journeyed on. But he also stopped to build an altar and to adore. He built an altar to the name of the Lord. He called on the Lord. Every person in every civilization throughout time has been seeking the divine. If you ask archaeologists and anthropologists, it's a universal character. People pray. People raise their eyes. They seek help beyond themselves. So this is what Abram teaches us. This is what this city actually teaches us. And one of the most beautiful expressions of the fact that we are made, we are wired for God, and all civilizations are looking for him, was actually written by St. Luke when he was accounting or speaking about, you know, what the apostles did. Since we're looking at what the apostles professed, what faith did they profess? I think it would be neat to read this part. He's speaking about St. Paul's journey. Well, he talks about St. Paul a lot, but if you go to chapter 17, he's speaking about when Paul went to Greece. And if you remember, up on the Areopagus, they've got all of these altars to unknown gods and different things. And this is what he writes. And this is what Paul was saying to them. He says, "What therefore you worship as unknown, I proclaim to you, the God who made the world and everything in it, being Lord of heaven and earth." So that's the first part of our faith. This is what the apostles preached. And actually, that comes from our Jewish heritage, his first revelation to our father in faith, Abraham. "This God does not live in shrines made by man," like these high places here, "nor is he served by human hands as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to all men life and breath and everything." Now, this is the most important thing right here. "And he made from every nation of men to live on all the face of the earth, having determined allotted periods and the boundaries of their habitation, that they should seek God in the hope that they might feel after him and find him. For yet he is not far from each one of us." He made us for himself. And as St. Augustine said, that many, you know, that fantastic theologian from the 4th century, he said, our hearts are made for him, are made for you. He's addressing himself to the Lord. "And we are restless until we rest in you."